Superfly. Snuka. Ducks under
a wild swing. Comes back off those ropes with a double flange, with a double forearm. And here he goes.
There we go.
He goes to the top.
Hello.
Superfly is on the way. Look at him go.
And welcome to Pro Wrestling This Week. I'm Joe Pedicino.
And I'm Gordon Solie. And during the next hour, we're going to have a lot of excitement for you as we travel from Portland, Oregon to Montreal, Canada. Your international match of the week in San Juan, Puerto Rico. Jimmy Snuka returns, and we'll be having our Matt Classic dating back to the year 1955. Our PWI report will come to us from Bill Apter in New York City. And Joe, what about our opening match today?
We're going to start off this week, Gordon, in Dallas, Texas. You know, the Von Erichs have been having their problems with one Brian Adias ever since he turned on the Von Erichs. Well, now, Lance Von Erich gets an opportunity in the main event this week to take on Brian Adias in Dallas, Texas. So let's go to Bill Mercer and our friends in World Class Championship Wrestling and watch just what happens when the Von Erichs get their hands on a turncoat.
Lance Von Erich trying to keep that right shoulder up with the pressure. And the pain forces shoulders back to the mat. There's a break. Brock Golovich, the referee in charge. And it is going up for a body slam. He does that. And Conley gets set to come off the middle rope. Waiting for Lance Von Erich. Diving and missing. Brian Adias timing his dive on top of Lance Von Erich, but Lance Von Erich timed it better. And fighting on one leg now. Lance popping away on Brian Adias. Brian on the fly. Up and over. Lance Von Erich trying to get the feeling back, trying to overcome the pain of that left knee. Firing a shot at Brian Adias. Gives him a knee into the midsection. That slows up the man from Oliken. And a shot to the head. Another one. And Adias ripping Von Erich over the top rope. The bell will ring. That is a disqualification for Adias because he obviously tossed Brian over the top rope, but this battle is not over yet. Boom! Just a move in time by Lance as they fight it out on the floor, and Lance now can open up with everything. And the bell is rung, the battle is over, but they're not through yet after all that. Golovich trying to separate him, and Lance Von Erich gets a little more now because of what Brian Adias, and a chance to get some revenge for the Von Erich. Here comes Al Madrill in. Al Madrill stomping into Lance Von Erich. Al Madrill protecting his partner. And Adias with Madrill's help, and a pummel and battle and smash at Lance Von Erich. After Lance had already been the winner in this one. But now both these World Tag Team Champions, though they sort of tarnished the name champion. And here comes the Dingo Warrior. The Dingo Warrior getting ready to take on both of them. And he does and sends them flying. The Dingo Warrior coming to the aid of Lance Von Erich. Lance is the winner. Here's Mark Lorenz.
In 8 minutes, 15 seconds, Lance Von Erich is the winner of the bout after being thrown over the top rope.
Lee, sky-high Lee, just picks him up. He's going to set him right down on the turnbuckle. There we go, just like that.
Well, Gordon, obviously it's going to be tough for any of the Von Erichs, it looks like, to have a real one-on-one confrontation with Brian Adias as long as Al Madrill is around.
Certainly, no question about that. Let's leave Texas now and go on up to the great Northwest. I'm talking about Portland, Oregon, and we're going to be seeing a newcomer to pro wrestling this week. He's 7 feet tall, weighs 310 pounds. His name is Sky High Lee. We're going to watch him as he goes up against a very tough opponent in Verne Siebert. Let's go to Portland.
Ladies and gentlemen, the next event will be one fall. Introducing in this corner, 238 pounds from Canada, Verne Siebert. His opponent in this corner, 300 pounds from Charlotte, North Carolina, Sky High Lee.
Sky High Lee, and he certainly is, and Vicious Verne Siebert joining us in the crow's nest right now. Mr. Ricky Santana, welcome aboard, Ricky. Boy, I tell you, you've got Indian strap matches. You've got the big tag match coming up, title match next Saturday night. How'd you pull that one off?
Well, I think that Don Owens' promotion finally realized that it's about time that Miller and Abudadeen defended those titles. You know, they only defend them once every 30 days, and their time's just about up.
You know, there's also a talk that you've been talking to Don Owen, and there may be some talk with the commission about Rip Oliver putting his belt on the line.
Yes, Rip Oliver is another one. I think that's just the clan syndrome where they hold on to those belts right up until the wire, and that's got to come to an end because there's a lot of vulnerable challengers here like myself and Coco, and the Sky High Lee is no slouch, as you can see for yourself.
Well, I tell you, this, look at that. Siebert's got to jump way up there. He can just barely touch his hand. This guy is... has really been creating a whole lot of talk throughout the Northwest, hasn't he, Ricky?
Oh, yes, he has. I mean, look at him. He's a behemoth. When you look at him, he's 7 foot, and he's 300-plus pounds. That's not your average man.
No, that's for sure. Ricky Santana planted a boot in the midsection of Sky High Lee, and Sky High Lee just picks him up. He's going to set him right down on the turnbuckle. There we go, just like that. And, oh, a little slap across the face. Oh, that's got to really infuriate him.
I think that's more of an insult to Verne Siebert. That's just to let him know that Sky High is here to do business. He's not here to play.
Well, there's not going to be any playing going on starting tomorrow. You guys are all over the Northwest, starting in Findlay tomorrow, then Yakima, Wenatchee. There's a big grudge match, I understand, in Longview on the 14th.
Oh, yeah, I got grudge matches and strap matches with Miller all over the Pacific Northwest, and it's got to come to an end sooner or later. Miller, I know you're tough, but I'm going to show you what it's like to get into lights with a Ricky Santana.
Well, you're going to have that chance Thursday the 15th in Salem at the Armory. Oh, Sky High Lee nailed him. Boy, he really chopped him down.
Yeah, with that big foot of his, that size 22, I guarantee you, wherever you get hit with that, you're not going to get up.
Well, Siebert was lucky to get back up.
Well, I think at 7 feet tall and 310 pounds, we can look for major things in the future from Sky High Lee. Right now, it's time to go to New York City in the offices of Pro Wrestling Illustrated Magazine. Senior editor Bill Apter has ratings for us this week and a very interesting commentary about what's going on with Lex Luger. Let's take it to New York City and Bill Apter.
This is senior editor of Pro Wrestling Illustrated Magazine, Bill Apter, and today, ratings for the National Wrestling Alliance and also rankings of the top 10 women in the sport and a special editorial. Lex Luger moves into the national spotlight. Right now, ratings for the National Wrestling Alliance. And here they are, the top 10 women in the sport today as rated by Pro Wrestling Illustrated Magazine. Lex Luger has left Florida and gone to the World Championship area. Now, we commend PWI's 1986 Rookie of the Year for this good career move and for staying in Florida during this rookie year and perfecting his craft. However, Luger seems to have gotten his priorities a bit confused in the World Championship area. Now, Luger has told Barry Windham, his former friend and tag team partner in Florida, that he intends to join the Four Horsemen, that this will yield him more money and be a better career move. However, Lex Luger, the man who held Ric Flair to a draw several times in Florida and secured that place in the top 10 ratings in the NWA, might not have that chance anymore. Why? Because most of the Four Horsemen don't get a shot at Ric Flair's title. Now, you know what this means. This will deny Lex Luger his chance at immortality and also deny the fans these classic Ric Flair, Lex Luger matches. Next week, Craig Peters will join me for some real hot rumors about WrestleMania number 3. Also, PWI's top 10 ratings and ratings for the WWF. Till next time, this is Bill Apter. See you at the matches.
Well, it's certainly going to be interesting to see what the future holds for one Lex Luger. There's no question about it. He's an outstanding athlete. The future should be bright indeed. Whether his choice was correct, only time will tell. Now then, we'll be back with more action right after we pause and let the station make a little money.
Mixing it up. It's a brawl.
Welcome back to Pro Wrestling This Week. There have been reports that the Rock and Roll RPMs are going to start dividing their time up between the world-class area that we left just a few minutes ago and the Memphis area. Right now, we've got a match in Memphis, Tennessee, as the Rock and Roll RPMs, the tag team champions, take on Garmen and Trailer. Let's watch the Memphis tag champions in action.
Randy.
All right, Lance. Mike Davis, Tommy Lane, the Rock and Roll RPMs from Atlanta, Georgia, against the team from Mississippi, Jerry Garmen and Benny Trailer. Vicious clothesline there by Mike Davis. No doubt about it, the Southern Tag Team Champions are a very rugged team. A double elbow in Lance already. They're all over Garmen and Trailer.
You know, I can't believe that the guy, I try to get him to stop and talk normally. You can't stop him talking. They just eat your ear off. And today they didn't even want to stop and talk about that last chance match.
That was a first for the Rock and Roll RPMs, no doubt about it. Here's another tag. Here comes Mike Davis in the ring, double teaming now by the Rock and Roll RPM. We have a Benny Trailer in, and he slammed down with a body slam count on one, and Mike Davis refused to go for the pin. He tags Lane, and he comes in, Lance.
They're giving up a total weight. Garmen and Trailer are about 30 pounds or so, and they're, of course, giving up a lot of experience that the Rock and Roll RPMs have. Garmen and Trailer, a doggone good team. Benny right now getting slammed by Tommy Lane as he's trying to tag Jerry Garmen. Doesn't make the tag, but the tag is accomplished on Mike Davis. Dropped down across that with a backbreaker. One, two. Did he get it?
He got it.
He got it. I couldn't see whether he got that third one or not. I guess I was listening more than anything as we were reaching for the bell rope. So Mike Davis, Tommy Lane, the Southern Tag Champs, the Rock and Roll RPM, come out with a victory.
And so the RPMs notch up another victory. Now we're going to go to our Matt Classic, and that goes back to the year 1955. Two of the greatest names in pro wrestling in that time, Dangerous Danny McShane and Gino Garibaldi. Two great names in wrestling. We're going to watch these two in a 2 out of 3 falls match. This week, we're going to see the first fall. I might point out that Danny McShane is now retired. He's had both hips replaced, but is still very active from the standpoint of refereeing matches. Let's watch Danny McShane going up against Gino Garibaldi.
He's got his toe locked underneath Gino's back. Gino's getting groggy. It's a half strangle. It's a half strangle. Rufus Ruby says it is not a strangle. Ruby's very close to it. Fans are telling Mike to break it up because whenever Danny has a chance, he exerts the strangle pressure and he's breaking it up.
Break it up.
Ruby's forcing him to break it up. Ruby pulls McShane off. Here comes Danny in again. Him against the cross buckle. Really pounding his head in there. There's the Irish cannonball. 1, 2, 3. So Danny McShane, after softening Gino up with a figure four head scissors and half strangle, wins the fall with the Danny McShane Irish cannonball. And that's the way it goes down in the books.
So the first fall of our Mat Classic goes to Danny McShane. We'll have fall number two as our Mat Classic next week. And speaking of Mat Classics, Gordon, I understand we're celebrating your birthday this week.
We are indeed. I'm 39 again. We'll take a quick timeout.
As the action is fast and furious, in that ring, Jimmy Superfly Snuka, doing his...
back to Pro Wrestling This Week, and Joe, I know you joined me and millions of wrestling fans around the world that are congratulating Superfly Jimmy Snuka for his triumphant return.
That's right. Gordon, you know, recently in the AWA, Snuka was injured at the hands of Colonel DeBeers when he pushed him off the top rope just before one of those magnificent Superfly leaps. Then he proceeded to go outside the ring and do two devastating face-front pile drivers into the concrete. Snuka, in the hospital and really not expected to return this soon, has made a triumphant return. Let's go to the AWA and see what happens when the Superfly returns as he takes on Rick Gantner. So let's see the return of the Superfly.
Snuka. You see the heavy, the black tape on his wrists and on his ankles. And before the match tonight, I asked him why. And it's because of the Superfly move that he makes to strengthen the ankles and the wrists to preclude them from being injured. He'll come off that top rope and he will be in the most fantastic moves and maneuvers, the Superfly, that you will may ever have a chance to see. And hopefully we will have a chance to see it all here in this one against Rick Gantner, because he is such a super athlete. Jimmy Superfly Snuka, wrist lock.
And he got the title by flying. It says that human beings can't fly. This man was the first to fly through the air and win wrestling matches. Okay, we're in the ring now at the Showboat with Jimmy Superfly Snuka, Fijian, lives in the islands right now, travels around the world. Rick Gantner trying to prove that he is better than the man from Fiji. The fans love him, we love him, and he is just a super guy.
And what a look of determination on his face, and I'm sure we will get a close-up of that as this match goes on. The Superfly, maybe the nickname came from his cliff diving off the cliffs of the Fiji Islands. Referee Bob Warren is coming over. Come on in a little closer, Bob. But they're taking him to a hospital as the action is fast and furious. In that ring, Jimmy Superfly Snuka doing his thing.
Okay, outside the ring, Gantner goes out, and he did the wisest move because Jimmy is winding up. He just slipped into second gear. He'll go into third, he'll hit fourth in the sport car and go into overdrive, and that's when he flies. Jimmy, the Superfly Snuka.
And when he hits it into high gear, it's hardly anything but a blur. Oh! The O for the spitting tactic of one Rick Gantner. He does not like what is going on, and look at the Superfly bringing him back into the ring. And now, Jimmy Superfly Snuka goes to work. Wow, what a hip lock takedown that was off the side headlock.
Jimmy Snuka is a man who knows his wrestling, and he likes to use it. He doesn't just do spectacular things to make the fans happy. What he does is to wrestle his man, get a great workout, and then hopefully polish him up. I don't think he's lost many matches. He's one of the greatest records, has one of the greatest records in the world. Okay, here he is right now. Jimmy Superfly Snuka.
Ducks under a wild swing. Oh, comes back off those ropes with a double sledge, with a double forearm. And here he goes.
There we go.
He goes to the top.
Jimmy
the Superfly is on the way. Look at him go. Oh, unbelievable.
Aloha. So far, he's gone.
Well, certainly, Jimmy Superfly Snuka, 100% recovered and out after Colonel DeBeers. Let's travel now to Fort Worth, Texas, in the Universal Wrestling Federation, as we watch one of the most outstanding competitors in the world, the Missing Link, take on one of the most loquacious wrestlers in the world, Michael Hayes. Let's take a look at the action.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is a singles event featuring, escorted to the ring by the lovely Sunshine, Michael Purely Sexy Hayes.
Michael P.S. Hayes. And my often color commentator on the Universal Wrestling Federation program is equally adept in the squared circle as he is in the broadcast booth. But he will have to reach down and be ready to go and be ready to really get it on, because the Missing Link has one style and one style only. He does use his head in the ring, and he uses it very physically. And the Missing Link, along with Dark Journey, this should be a great one right here on Power Pro Wrestling.
And now, Hayes' opponent in this event, brought to the ring by manager Dark Journey, the Missing Link.
Well, Doyle this King, man is with that ball, wireless microphone, getting out of the ring, and Michael Hayes perhaps taking what he considers the best opportunity that he can, because the Link is a physical man, and Hayes taking the advantage and taking it very, very quickly here on this matchup here on Power Pro Wrestling. Michael Hayes with a very quick advantage. And Hayes, who has a total disdain for Dark Journey. She has had her problems with Michael Hayes. And her rejection of Michael Hayes has not set well too well with P.S. And the Link coming right back, using his head and putting Hayes down. But Michael Hayes relentless on this evening of wrestling action from the Cowtown Coliseum next to the world's largest honky-tonk, Billy Bob's, Texas. And Hayes throwing the Link into the rail and over the rail near the front row of ringside. Hayes hammering away at the Missing Link, and the Link back into the ring. This match, one fall, or television time remaining. Michael Hayes now with a blatant choke. And he will use the count as well as anybody. Hayes going for a kick, but the Missing Link with a headbutt. And Hayes went down. And Hayes once again put flat on his back by the powerful Missing Link. And it's a Link.
Our feature match continues right after we pause for these commercial messages.
Let's go back now to Fort Worth, Texas, and our feature match of the week between Michael Hayes and the Missing Link.
The Link attempted to come down with his head on Michael Hayes, but Hayes moved out of the way. Hayes pulling himself back up. The Link with a headbutt, and Hayes is being battered. But there's the Angel of Death. The Angel of Death and Freebird.
the Freebirds on a rampage in the UWF, and they don't seem to care who they hurt, Gordon. And as you know, we've had our problems with the Freebirds also.
We have indeed. Recently, of course, Terry Gordy refused to appear on this program and accept the PWI Award for the Most Improved Wrestler of the Year.
That's right. Now, the UWF got in touch with us, and they wanted us to know that they didn't feel that way. So we are preempting P.S. Rumors with Michael Hayes this week to present this special interview with Gordon Solie and the representative of the UWF, Jim Ross.
Well, it's certainly a pleasure to have with me today one of the great voices in professional wrestling. He is the voice of the Universal Wrestling Federation, Mr. Jim Ross. Welcome aboard.
Gordon, thank you very much for allowing me this time. I want to say to the wrestling fans, it's a sincere privilege for me to be here with you, one of my idols for a long time here in wrestling.
Well, thank you so much, Jim. But your purpose here today is representing the UWF regarding this controversy with Terry Gordy, who refused to accept the Pro Wrestling Illustrated Award as the Most Improved Wrestler of the Year.
That's exactly right. The wrestling fans voted Terry Gordy the Most Improved Wrestler of 1986. Gordy's comments, "How can you improve on perfection?" And the Freebirds' attitude is indicative of the way that we deal with them on a weekly basis. They're very hard to get along with, very individualistic. And Michael Hayes has made his comments on this program extremely clear toward his feelings on the award and on Bill Apter. But on behalf of the Universal Wrestling Federation, Gordon, I think that we have a much different attitude and we'd be very happy to accept that award.
Well, it's certainly our pleasure on behalf of Bill Apter and Pro Wrestling Illustrated then to present this to the Universal Wrestling Federation, one of course, the strongest wrestling federations in the nation today. And Jim, my wish to you is continued success.
Gordon, thank you very much. It's great being here and seeing you again. And I do want to tell the fans that on behalf of Terry Gordy, he may not agree with this, but we're going to accept this award for the wrestling fans of the country. We love you and thank you very much for your support.
Jim Ross, a representative of the UWF and, of course, the well-known voice of wrestling for the UWF. It's time now to journey to Montreal, Canada, and we're going to watch two outstanding competitors, Hercules Ayala going up against Dan Roy. I think you're going to find this match most entertaining.
Have you, in your experience, come across a man who not only has the size, he has a good grounding in the technical aspects of professional wrestling, and boy, is he mean. And I'm talking about the guy we just saw hurl Daniel Wall like a baby, Hercules Ayala. Have you ever encountered a character like this, so tough, so mean, right off the bat?
Well, I'll tell you, man, Hercules Ayala, over 6'2" tall, 280 pounds, he's big. He is strong and he is mean, but as you mentioned, he's got a tremendous wrestling knowledge. He's able to go in there and wrestle, and if it comes down to it, he likes to hurt his opponents.
Well, you know something, Albert, that's interesting to know. I mean, we call Steve Strong, sadistic Steve Strong. Here's another one cut from the same kind of bolt or cloth. He likes to see his opponents carried out of that ring. He likes to destroy them, not just defeat them.
Well, that's true, Milk. You know, we mentioned Steve Strong, we call him the sadistic one. Out of the same mold, he is the same type wrestler. He's as big, he's as strong, and he's just as mean, which makes him very dangerous.
Well, he also has a number of years' experience, and you talk about someone's reputation preceding him. Ayala's has certainly done that here to International Wrestling. Look at this. Oh, beautiful suplex by Ayala.
This moves in professional wrestling.
And there's now first we saw the fact that he does have that good technical foundation. That was an excellent suplex. He could have pinned Daniel Roy, or at least it appeared that to be the case, after the suplex, but no, wanted to punish his younger, his smaller opponent a little bit further, lifted his head off the canvas, Albert. You know, when you combine that good technical knowledge with the kind of meanness that this man so obviously possesses and for which he has such a worldwide reputation, with the experience that he also possesses, it makes for one devastating and destructive individual. And there's a lot of wrestlers throughout the area covered here by International Wrestling that just better keep your eyes open at all times.
Well, you have to be very careful when you step into the ring with Hercules Ayala. As you mentioned, an international reputation all over the world. Now he's here at International Wrestling, as we see once again. He could pin his opponent, but no, he wants to hurt him, wants to punish him, wants the people to know he is the toughest, the strongest, and the meanest.
And now another man that likes to smirk and smile at the discomfort, pain, he's inflicting on his opponents. We saw that great big wide grin on his face, smiling to the crowd as he systematically goes about destroying young Daniel Roy. Look at that. The ease with which he has picked Roy up, carrying him on his shoulders just like a baby. Oh, and backwards. And folks, that's 280 pounds coming down full force backwards on Daniel Roy. Albert, I'm glad that mercifully at this point it's over for Daniel Roy. Hercules Ayala, very, very impressive here in his debut television match on International Wrestling.
Well, I'll tell you, Mitt, like him or not, I am impressed. I think you are impressed. And the fans, they have to be impressed with this individual. 280 pounds, terrific scientific knowledge. But again, like we said, he likes to hurt his opponents. And maybe one day that'll backfire on him.
Our action from Montreal, Canada, exciting as always. Now, it's time for Gary Hart's Viewpoint. As you know, we turn this time over to Gary Hart each week. Now, this week, his subject touches very close to home. Let's hear Gary Hart's viewpoint on Gordon Solie.
Today I have a message, and I hope you're listening, Gordon Solie. You sit there week after week and tell everybody how great Lex Luger is, how great Bruiser Brody is, and how great these other champions are. Well, why don't you spend 30 seconds of your time telling the people the greatest athlete in wrestling is Abdullah the Butcher, 486 pounds, unstoppable. Yeah, Gordon Solie, you are just like the rest of them for a long time. I thought you were a man of honor. I thought you were separate from everybody else. I thought that you had the guts to stand on television and tell the truth. So once, Solie, why don't you go back to the days the way you used to be and admit to the world that Abdullah the Butcher and Gary Hart are unstoppable. And for that, Gordon, once again, they'll call you the greatest.
Well, Gordon, Gary Hart makes no bones about it. He's not very happy about the way that we've covered him here on Pro Wrestling This Week or Abdullah the Butcher.
Well, all I can say about that, Joe, is that Gary Hart and others of his ilk are really not needed in professional wrestling. However, they have become very much a part of professional wrestling, and I suppose we're just going to have to put up with them. Abdullah the Butcher, one of the fiercest competitors in the world today, no question about that. Gary Hart, the evil genius in management and professional wrestling. We'll be back right after we pause.
Tremendo, espectacular, estimados amigos, dominando la grada de Puerto Rico.
Men against one another. Let's go see Carlos Colon as he takes on TNT.
Ahí le encaja Bachete de punta al cuello, le golpean en la cabeza, Galito da derechazo contra TNT. Se levanta la acrobata de Puerto Rico, viene con TNT, va el saque de cuerda, mis amigos, hay golpe al estómago violento, vuelta acrobática, mis amigos, ahí está el derechazo a la cabeza, ahí respondió TNT, pero Carlitos Colón con más violencia, con más energía contra TNT, lo tira de cabeza a la esquina del cuadrilátero, mis amigos, ahí está la llave de perro por parte de la acrobata, golpe a la cabeza, TNT se defiende, está en dificultades, Carlitos Colón lo lanza de hombro, mis amigos, ahí va Carlitos, patada voladora, derribado. TNT, mis amigos, qué emoción, qué maravilla, qué espectáculo, tremendo, espectacular, estimados amigos, dominando la acróbata de Puerto Rico, se lleva a TNT, ahí va Carlitos Colón, lo toma por el brazo izquierdo, volteando lentamente a TNT, viene con él, mis amigos, ahí está, lance de esquina, va tras él, se quita TNT y se castigó Carlitos Colón, lo mide TNT, patada karateca invertida contra Carlitos Colón y se fue a la lona.
Padín, y lo cierto es que Carlitos Colón se encolerizó y estaba dominando bastante cómodo a TNT.
Perdón, Moyano, mira esto, la cobra dinamita, ahí está, una cobra dinamita contra Carlitos Colón, ahí está buscando la escapada, Carlitos Colón se impulsa en las cuerdas, se llevan al árbitro, pero lo retiene la cobra dinamita, ahí lo tiene la cobra dinamita, mis amigos. Carlitos Colón está en dificultades y esa cobra de Navita es peligrosísima. Carlitos Colón se impulsó en las cuerdas nuevamente, no ha podido escaparse. A la verdad que se le ha puesto difícil la cosa, Carlitos Colón vuelve, intento fallido por Carlitos. Lo sigue reteniendo en la cola dinamita, momento peligroso, mis amigos. ¿Qué es esto, bendito? Me está grabando de Puerto Rico, mis amigos. Se hallan dificultades, a punto de perder la faja. Ay, se tambaleó. Mira, mis amigos, Ahí acaba de entrar nada menos, mira, que el profe. Ahí está, le metió tremendo golpe a Carlitos Colón. Con una maleta, con algo, con un bulto. Vuelve ahora y se aprovecha ahora TNT y le aplica la cosa dinamita a Carlitos Colón después que había logrado zafarse de ella, que nadie podría lograr una cosa como esa. Y vieron ustedes cómo ahora se aprovechó este señor profe de una forma indebida. Y mira lo que acaba de hacer, estimados amigos. Ahí lo tiene casi dormido con la bola dinamita, Boyano, mira eso.
Padilla, el árbitro está haciendo la indicación, no sabemos si es acá la mesa, está señalando hacia el lado opuesto de que suene la campana.
Sí, mis amigos, el árbitro manda para el encuentro, pero vieron ustedes lo que hizo el profe. ¡Qué poca vergüenza, mis amigos! Ahí está ahora el profe en la cabeza, mis amigos. Ahora se supone que venga TNT. Vamos a ver. Ahí está TNT. ¿Qué pasa? ¿Qué es lo que está pasando aquí, mis amigos? ¿Qué está pasando aquí? Está reclamando la faja él. Pero mira, se supone que ahora TNT va y despierta a Carlitos Colón. ¿Qué pasa?
Estoy haciendo las indicaciones al árbitro de que tiene que despertar a Carlitos Colón.
Sí, pero tiene que despertar a Carlitos Colón.
El árbitro está pidiendo la correa, no se ha dado cuenta, está no bien, se ha percatado el árbitro.
Pero no han despertado a Carlitos Colón todavía. Ahí tiene que... No despiertan todavía, vamos a ver qué pasa, mis amigos. Le está exigiendo que lo despierte, vamos a ver. Ahí está, mis amigos, Carlitos Colón sigue la bola.
Está botando espuma.
Mira, está botando por la espuma. Sí, exactamente, una espuma por la boca, Carlitos Colón. Está en dificultades, pero mira, no lo quiere despertar, ¿qué va a hacer? Pero mira, parece que se va a ir del cuadrilátero, ¿qué hacemos, Moyano? Ahí, mira, se llevó la banda, lo despertó, Moyano. Bendito, pero ¿qué va a hacer con Carlitos Colón ahora?
The sleeper hole, of course, is a lethal hole, and may we offer this admonishment to all of you right now. Don't try this on your friends or neighbors, particularly you youngsters. This is indeed a lethal hold. A physician had to be called in. Colon was then taken to the hospital where he was desperately ill for several hours. Thank heavens, however, he is totally recovered now. Joe, what's going on in the WWF?
Well, Gordon, our World Wrestling Federation ring report this week pertains to rumors about matches at WrestleMania 3, and unfortunately, those continuing problems between Andre the Giant and Hulk Hogan. Now, this week on Piper's Pit, an award was presented to Andre the Giant for being undefeated in the WWF over the past 15 years. Hogan came out to congratulate Andre. Things looked great until Andre just turned around and walked away. And it does appear to us now that those problems between Andre the Giant and Hulk Hogan are spreading. Rumors about matches at WrestleMania 3, one of the big ones going around this week, King Kong Bundy taking on Kamala, two giant men in the ring. Bundy, in an interview this week, said that he was not impressed with the size of Kamala or the agility, and he feels like he's a much superior large man. That's our WWF Ring Report for this week. Now, Gordon, I understand that in Continental, a card game has decided the fate and the manager of the Headhunters.
It did indeed. Two of the most flamboyant men in professional wrestling today, Nature Boy Buddy Landel and Kevin Sullivan, the Mystic One, got into a card game. And of all things, the Headhunters became the prize. Well, Landel won it. Sullivan says maybe he cheated, maybe he didn't, but nonetheless, Landel is the new owner and manager of the Headhunters. We're going to take a look now, as you'll see Kevin Sullivan and Buddy Landel at ringside, along with the Headhunters, as the Headhunters take on Rufus Jones, Al Scott, and Les Freeman. But watch what other action takes place in Birmingham.
But nonetheless, Scott trying to battle his way back.
We're talking about management here. See, it just shows the intelligence of the Nature Boy here, outdoing Kevin Sullivan in the card game. And that's the same thing I'm going to do to all of our opponents. Hey, look, Kevin could only do so much with this guy, okay? I'm not knocking Kevin, okay? He's a hell of a wrestler. He's a hell of a man. But don't get me wrong. He's not no Nature Boy Buddy Landel. And when they broke the mold, they made me, baby. And I'm trying to tell you, I'm going to take these guys to the top, you know, rather than where they've been.
Yeah, that's an interesting observation from a man whose humility is somewhat lost in the process. And now the New Guinea Headhunter is a double blast in the back.
There is strength in numbers.
Okay, well, point well taken, strength in numbers. And once again, they've got Scott up. And almost a semi-power slam into the canvas on Scott. They bring Scott up again and again, more punishment. And I would... Ooh, the Headhunter hurtling over that top rope.
I can't move myself, Gordon. I love it. I told him everything they know.
All right, well, they have defeated that team. Well, now, wait a minute. They have defeated the team. Yeah, but now, wait a minute. They've already won the match. There's no need for any further damage.
Hey, this is a message, Gordon Solie. This is a message to Fuller's, to Jimmy Golden's, to Bob Armstrong's, to all of these guys, the Nightmares. This is a message right here. Punish them, tear their heads off, and spit between their shoulders, baby.
Well,
message, Gordon Solie, what a better way to do it, huh?
Well, I don't know that I would agree with that at all. Now they've got one man outside the ring. They continue to punish Burhead Jones. Landel, you ought to put a stop to this.
Hey, I'll put a stop to it when I get ready to. When I get ready to. Not when you or anybody else deems it necessary. When I... Hey, what are these guys doing out here, man?
Well, I don't know, but... Hey, I'll tell you what, you can hear the crowd coming alive.
Hey, I'd like to be out here whatsoever, dude.
Well, the camera hasn't picked it up yet because they can't. But I can assure you that there are some people moving toward the ring.
And you didn't really stop them. They didn't have to come out here and butt their nose in my business.
Well, somebody's butting their nose in it, that's for sure. And they've decided that there's not going to be any more of that. And there you go. The Tennessee Stud is out there launching an attack. The Tennessee Stud, and brother, he is meeting out his own kind of justice right now. He's got him back in the ring, all 6'9" of him.
Yes, my men are coming out here, and they get their hands raised in victory. A great debut and victory for the Nature Boy. And what happens? Ron Fuller, everybody knows the Tennessee Stud's Ron Fuller. Robert Fuller and Jimmy Golden come out.
Well, sir, I'll tell you what.
I'll show you something. I'm going to stop this thing my way, and I'm going to show you and everybody how to stop.
All right, Buddy Landel making his own threats. Meanwhile, Jimmy Golden has one of the headhunters outside the ring. Big atomic knee drop. He's got him down. By the way, don't forget the big battle of Birmingham. 10 of the finest tag teams in... Ooh, brother! Buddy Landel catching the Tennessee Stud from behind. Broke that cane right over his back. Is now putting a choke to him. Next week, next Monday night, of course, the big... Battle of Birmingham, 10 of the finest tag teams in the world will be here to compete. Buddy Landel continues to choke the Tennessee Stud. He's got the Stud in trouble. And we've got, and Landel now all of a sudden, there's the bullet. There's the bullet. There's the bullet. And the bullet is out there. And the bullet has Landel in trouble. And here comes Kevin Sullivan. Kevin Sullivan, and the bullet's caught him in a sleeper hold. Well, he's got him in a sleeper hold. And Kevin Sullivan trying to break away from it. Kevin Sullivan trying to break away.
In the shuffle in that last tag team match, rest assured you're going to see a lot more of Buddy Landel and the Headhunters. Well, Joe, our review board really had its problems picking the Wrestler of the Week.
Gordon, it was probably the hardest time we've had since we started awarding a Wrestler of the Week here on Pro Wrestling This Week. The review board literally split. Should it be Andre the Giant? After all, he was given that trophy this week for being undefeated in the WWF over the past 15 years. Or should it be Jimmy Superfly Snuka? He returned to the ring after that devastating injury and triumphant in his return. It went back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, and just minutes ago, a decision was reached. Our Wrestler of the Week, congratulations to Jimmy Superfly Snuka. Let's go back and see how he won his first match in the ring since that injury from Colonel DeBeers.
Ducks under a wild swing. Hook comes back off those ropes with a double sledge, with a double forearm, and here he goes.
There we go.
He goes to the top,
getting
the Superfly. Is on the way. Look at him go. Oh, unbelievable.
Aloha. So far, he's gone.
Jimmy Superfly Snuka triumphant in his return to the ring after that devastating injury from Colonel DeBeers, and you can count on the fact that he is going to plan on revenge against Colonel DeBeers. He's our Wrestler of the Week. Gordon, I know that we've got a great show coming up next week.
We have indeed. First of all, we'll be seeing the second fall in that 2 out of 3 falls Matt Classic back in 1955 between Dangerous Danny McShane and Gino Garibaldi. Our international match of the week will be from Tokyo, Japan. Bill Apter will return with his PWI report. We will have PS rumors with Michael Hayes and wrestling action from all over the United States. Till then, I'm Gordon Solie.
I'm Joe Pedicino. We'll see you back here same time, same station next week for Pro Wrestling This Week.
Oh, Dennis, next on TV 58 is a fantastic movie starring Henry Fonda and Susan Strasberg. Stage Direct follows the rise to stardom of a small-town girl. TV Guide says it's a well-made, interesting drama about the stage.
Stage Direct, next on TV 58. Well, I guess that means we're not going to be doing our taxes tonight, huh?